with Professor Ken Ueno on voice and electronics, or just, is it voice? It's just voice, right? Amplified voice. And then an interactive music system that I have designed called, this evening it's going to be Bob conducting six Maxines. that doesn't make any sense, but that's true for me. It's definitely how I understand
Maxines.
So we can talk about that. And so yeah, Ken's going to play with the system for a little while, and then afterwards, afterwards we're going to have a Q&A about how it's compared to playing with a person. And
you want to tell them what Maxine is?
Yeah, Maxine is my dissertation.
But it's a piece of software.
It's a piece of software, that's right, thank you. Yeah,
yes.
It's a piece of software, I designed.
Yes.
It's called a MaximusP.
What does it do?
It listens to you and us, and what do you think? You have a number in your hand, and I don't know what it is, so.
Performs on its own. Right?
It can do a solo too.
Yeah.
It can do a solo.
Okay.
It doesn't need you.
Yeah. Yes.
it's been nice enough to invite you along.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Is that the answer you're looking
with it
for?
Before.
Oh, and he's never played with it before. Right. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's opus
right.
One.
Yeah. Yeah. Any other basic facts of life I've forgotten to mention?
What is Bob? What is Bob?
Bob is Maxine's son.
Is machines procreate?
In a way, we'll talk about it later. So for now, it's Ken and Maxine and Bob.
Ah!
Oh. Thank you.
Which Maxine to jump in when, sort of playing Cobra with six Maxines, yeah. But how is it for you, is what I'm really curious about.
It's quite different from playing people.
Yeah, of course.
You don't have the same level of empathy, you know? You know, when someone's not playing, they're listening, and you can feel that. And that's one. And the other thing that was hard was form.
Yeah.
You know, often I like to build things up or say that on recall and then kind of have a longer trajectory. And especially when it was getting towards the end, I was trying to wait for a moment where it you told me where it would go out and
right.
then I could try to shape it myself, you know?
Yeah.
That's how I tried to end.
Yeah.
I knew it was kind of dying out, but then it was kind of a little bit more repetitive than I, you know?
right.
those kind of things. So I felt like I didn't have as much kind of agency to kind of shape the form
mm-hmm.
as much. And so sometimes it felt like I was playing with the tape part.
Okay. Yeah.
You know, that I had to respond to it, but it wasn't kind of giving me the same as much love as I was getting.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah, fair
yeah.
enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So you felt like with the person you would have with people you would have more of an ability to sort of shape the form and like
well, you would listen together more.
Yeah.
Hopefully, especially if they're people you trust or you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there'll be a little bit more of a kind of give and take. And I was trying to give it some solos and then kind of times. And then I started playing this game. It was like, oh, if I come in, would it like come in and look like we did an attack together?
And did that game?
Sometimes
that
it
game.
Did.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
That gave me a little notice of satisfaction. Like, we were,
right.
You know, like,
yeah.
music. But those little moments, you know?
Yeah.
But it was artificial because I felt like I was manufacturing it and doing
right.
the hard work for that. And I didn't feel it doing, you know, giving like that.
Right.
So
yeah.
So once I figured it out, well, sorry, it took me some time to kind of, I guess, figure out what it is and what
right,
it does
of course.
In the sound environment, right? So
yeah.
I guess that kind of game I was playing was after a while when I kind of figured out some of its own kind of internal rhythmic cadential gestations, right? Then I could like well, it lays out, it'll come in, and I can
okay.
try to come in to, you know, play these games of form myself, like kind
yeah.
of learning a little bit about it.
Yeah.
That I could feel like I could try to do something that hopefully would work a little bit better.
Yeah. Maybe it's kind of a funny question, but do you ever kind of learn to, you know, the way you describe like learning play with Maxine, like learning to sort of.
You do that with other people too.
This is
yeah.
what I always wonder. I don't know if it's like a vulgar question.
Any
ask.
Human relationship, that's key, and that's
yeah.
where the empathy comes in, you know? Like, I was trying to be empathetic to Maxine.
Right.
And I tend to learn its, you know, proclivities and likes and things and gesturally.
Right.
And then work together to try to make a compelling musical form.
Right.
No.
Yeah, and so you felt like it was very formless throughout the whole
well,
piece.
No, I mean, it had to kind of, I was trying to make it, before I get, I didn't, yeah, there were things I understood, I felt like algorithmically would statistically happen, right?
Like what?
Like densities of action, you know, and
you think
this guy would go off and then that, and then,
yeah.
you know, lay out for a certain amount of time that it would play at a certain point more often than others, or, you know,
right.
these kind of gestural statistical kind of things that give it form, too, but those are also moments that where it didn't need me, you know, so, but then inserted in that space, I had to become a Maxine, I guess, too.
Right.
To, you know.
Right, yeah.
To respond to it. So,
what did that involve? Yeah, go ahead.
Level,
yeah.
yeah, there was a point where, I guess if it kept going, it would be beyond maybe empathic to feeling more neocolonized.
You felt neocolonized?
No, I could imagine, and like it was beginning to, you know, right? Because it was just me just giving.
And you didn't feel like it was
giving you,
right?
It wasn't democratic.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It became the master, right? What George Lewis says, and
yeah,
right.
So you felt
yeah.
like it
it
led you mm-hmm. around in a way.
Well, like I had, in order to try to make a piece out of it, I felt like I had to, you know, kind of give to it,
right?
You know?
Feed it.
There was a certain moment where I felt like, oh, can I just ignore it? You know, but then it was playing enough that it was busy enough that I, you know. The form was being dictated by that, then I had to kind of insert myself more, right? Rather than, because there are different choices in improv. You could like coexist,
yeah. mm-hmm.
or you could have a conversation,
right.
or you could, you know?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, respond to it, and yeah. So those are choices that was like running through my head, and was, you know, until it became more, a little bit sparser, then there was more opportunity to, that I could do structural movements without having to kind of just play with the sound as well, right? And then there's space, so those things could be, you know, could be there with it, right? And then I could also play these games of, you know, attack or coincidence, plan, contrast, you know,
right,
in those spaces. That
right.
Then it became a little bit easier. But then it was kind of looping rather than having a trajectory,
mm-hmm.
right? So then I thought, okay, well, I knew it's going to end, then I could try to go until that happens and then try to hit the end after that happens.
Right.
All these things that I was thinking about, yeah.
Right, yeah. Just as you're talking about it, and I've never had a chance to ask anyone this question, was there a particular player in this ensemble of Maxine's that you felt like you had a closer relationship with, or that was more annoying, or that would fire this person? Or that, like, yeah.
I feel like overall, you know, that's the hard thing about improvising with more than, you know, three or four people.
Yeah.
Like, people tend to play too much.
Right.
You know, people tend to play too much anyway. So, well, then you have like six people, you know, right?
Right.
Like, often you gotta like coach people to, you know, listen more, lay out, and then
right.
serve the group, and right. And it's like a conversation. You can't always everybody be talking, right? It's kind of yeah. And also learning to be like present, even if you're not like playing, you know.
Right.
Right. Guitarists have this disease where they're trying to like, you know, shred all the time. And they're not listening, right? So, yeah. Sometimes it felt like that, right? It's like,
with my
and this guy's louder still.
Yeah,
a
this guy's
still
too loud.
Somehow statistically, this guy came out a bit more.
Right.
So, you know,
yeah.
So like, okay. Yeah. So I'll lay out when he comes in.
Now, when you tried to, you said you tried to ignore it. Like, what is it?
Okay, so
yeah.
As I was learning
yeah.
to be with it.
Yeah.
Then there are moments where, like, well, can I, no, you know, just coexist? Can we can just share the space together? How would that work? But then it was, like, busy enough that you couldn't kind of, you know, do that. Like in, you know, like the New York School of Music, where there's different statistical things that happen, but they're more delicate, and then they just happen. You don't know if they're happening together on purpose or not, or they, you know, this kind of thing. But, right. So that kind of strategy of interaction worked better at the end when it's sparser.
Yeah.
You know? When it's busier, I felt like I had to also kind of be a little bit more visceral along with it.
Right.
You know, but hopefully in a way that gives it space too, so that it feels more like a dialogue, even though it wasn't a dialogue.
Did you ever feel like you tried to ignore it, or that like you could ignore it, or that like, yeah? Did you ever try to like take your own stance with it? Or
well, I think I could, in general, ignore almost anything.
No,
you know, so that wasn't the issue.
Course.
It was like the issue was if I mean, it's trying to, you know, make a compelling performance.
Right. Yeah.
In collaboration
actually.
With it, and then so
right.
it was. I was at the early stage. I was running through my mind of like what. Can we do together?
Yeah.
You know, these like choices, and one of those choices, I felt like, oh, well, that doesn't feel, didn't fit, you know, feel as appropriate or as compelling at that moment. So I had to try to figure out another way to be with it.
So you felt it was very different than playing with a person, but then it also reminded you of playing with like bad players in some way, or like playing with players too much.
People who don't listen.
What kinds of things would you have wanted it to listen for? Is there anything in particular?
No, it's just, you know, like when you, even if not really saying anything, someone just listens, is there with you.
Right.
You know, that feeling. That feeling.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of the most precious things that I'm kind of used to and I look for in performing, and that's why we need audiences and also performing with people, that feeling, right?
Right.
Like families have that feeling.
Yeah.
You don't have to say anything to each other, but it feels comfortable, right?
Sometimes it's
you
better
know?
If you don't.
Right?
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I like that feeling
right.
when performing together with people.
Right.
You know? And so if I were to be most critical, is the that's the thing that I love most about playing with people, and it didn't feel like that.
Right, right. Yeah, of course. It's all very easy to understand. Now, because I'm so shitty at asking questions, and if you read my dissertation, you also get to see I'm really bad at it in any language. And so, yeah, if any of you have any questions for him, please reserve your questions for him.
I guess.
Well, my question is for you. You want me to ask you another time?
No, actually, why don't you go ahead? But I would, it would be great if there were questions for
my question for you is, have you ever interviewed someone who enjoyed playing with Maxine?
It has happened.
Yeah, and what did they like about it? What did they enjoy about it?
They enjoyed the fact that that it does actually many of the things precisely that he said that he didn't quite like about it.
They felt that that was a
benefit of, uh-huh. of that, of all of those same traits.
Oh.
Yeah, not all of them, but things like what you're saying of like the empathy that some players had felt, for example, that some they were playing with players that were too empathetic and that it became
uh-huh.
nauseating for them
uh-huh.
to have to play with players like that.
Uh-huh.
That's not a joke. That's
Yeah,
but yes, I have.
Good.
Yes, in the back.
Quick question for you again, sorry.
Yeah. Sure.
What is Maxine listening for, or
Mitch.
Supposed to be listening
Mitch.
For?
Maxine's only sonic input is pitch and amplitude. Bob listens for other features like noisiness and the spectral centroid and spectral roughness, spectral flux. There was another one. A few more timbrally focused features. That's what Bob listens for.
So what does Maxine do with the multiphonic?
What Maxine does with the multiphonic is that whatever pitch the pitch detector we decide that multiphonic is, that's what Maxine has decided that pitch is. And so it reacts to that.
Are you using fiddle or are you
the pitch tilde, which is based on fiddle.
Okay.
Which is based on Miller puckets.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Are you doing some filtering things for the analysis?
No.
Really?
No.
Okay.
No. It's all just raw. It's all raw. I've never filtered things. I don't know if that's better.
Okay.
Yes. Fred.
Maybe it's sort of for Ken. I played with Maxine when she was an infant. Wouldn't you say?
Yes. Yes.
A long time ago. And at the time, I mean, I was definitely in the camp of not really enjoying playing with Maxine at the time. But I was wondering, have you done much stuff with pedals and processing that you're controlling?
Sure.
Because to me,
I started out as a guitar player, so
okay.
I mean, all those toys were really,
and you
really,
know,
cool,
you know about guitar
and,
players.
And then, and then when I first started using Max MSP, I started. My first inclination was, okay, maybe I can do this with my voice. But then, with the presence of technology, I realized people listen differently,
right.
And I work hard to do some like heavy lifting and sing more than one pitch and stuff like that. And people will say, well, what patch is it? And so. I started moving away from it and mainly using that kind of technology for like installations and things where, you know, it becomes a proxy for the human. But when I'm performing, I prefer to not use anything or just a mic or a megaphone.
Right. Could I ask,
yeah.
To me, like at the time, and I don't know if it's
yeah.
different now, but it was really kind of just like a very wonky effects pedal, you know?
Yeah.
And that, like, sort of the enjoyment could come from not necessarily feeling like this is my partner that I'm collaborating with as much as it's just it's a processing system that I don't have any control over, you know. And that like
yeah.
some pedals are kind of interesting that way, where you know, like you don't really know what you're going to get, and you know, and it responds differently depending on the situation, the room. If you're like with the cello, especially, you know, kind of the rest of everything kind of impacts what happens, what goes out of the pickup through the pedals. And so, like, I was wondering if you thought about approaching Maxine not as a partner, but as just an effects pedal. Or if that, during the performance, that
well,
kind of
I like that
out.
It wasn't processing my sound.
Yeah, but it's
I
not
like
really
that.
Processing your sound, but at the same time, you,
yeah.
You know, it's an instrument that you're, you know, to think of it
yeah.
is that it's sort of colonizing you. You could also at the same time think of it as like, it's a piano that's kind of insisting, when I play a piano, I get a piano sound. You
yeah.
know, I don't get a flute sound, you know, and when I would play with Maxine, I would imagine that I get, and that's a thing rhythmic that I think you can think there's six Maxines, but I think to the audience, to myself, it's one instrument that happens to have an exciting spatial location
right.
concept, but it's one thing, and that might be something like Cam was talking about, to pare down and have this one thing not be six things all doing things, but just one thing that has a space idea, but
yeah.
But that, you know, so that you don't think of, I mean, I haven't played with this thing, it was a decade ago, right? I mean, it's come
yeah.
a long, long way,
right.
too, I want to say that.
Oh, okay.
But
I think so, too.
Oh, okay.
But at the same time,
no,
it still feels like it's not necessarily processing you,
yeah.
but it's a thing that you are, you're the human in the room, you know, the adult in the room, whatever, and that, you know, and that it is a problematic thing of like this instrument has a tendency to, like, you try to play a chord on the piano and then the piano goes like, ah, look at all the things I can do, you know,
yeah.
and like to find a way where the human interaction is a little less, that they can really pull back and it pulls back, or that sometimes Ken pulls back and it says, ah, Ken's not going to play for a while, I'm going to play, oh, Ken's singing, I'm going to shut up for a while and really let Ken do his thing. And this larger expanse of there was, to me, it's not mid-range, but there's a kind of a middle level of activity statistically, Ken might say, throughout the whole thing where the instrument was almost too consistently, it was like a fuzz pedal, it does the fuzz pedal thing, you know,
mm-hmm.
and it's kind of interesting, it's a really good fuzz pedal and it does a lot of kind of odd stuff depending on how much I push it, but it's always that thing.
Oh. I can also imagine, like, with like machine learning or something like that.
Which it's not a machine learning system. I should make that clear.
Yeah, yeah. But
same,
I imagine maybe if
it's basically
it analyzes
the same
enough,
that Fred played with
if it,
8 years ago.
Maybe if it analyzes enough things that a particular person, enough performances,
right.
maybe, then it can learn certain tendencies and things that maybe begin to feel almost human.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Right.
If the goal is to become,
yeah.
Does Maxi
want
to be human?
What do you want it to do eventually?
Like, I've always wanted it to play like improvisers that I like. You know, that's been the idea. And then after a while, I felt like it was sufficiently interesting, so I just sort of gave up on trying to develop it further and sort of started to take responsibility for how it played,
mm.
in terms of like just by which I mean like I didn't try and change it, I just sort of like from performance to performance just sort of got used to how it played.
Sure.
And then in Berlin, ripped a new one by improvisers in Berlin about Maxine over and over again, and that's where Bob came from. Is Bob is supposed to sort of atone for Maxine's sins. And we didn't hear Bob because Bob actually has a whole different set of sounds that it uses, which are very Berlin, you know, very very like it does all the Berlin things because I like those things.
Yeah.
But to answer your question, yeah, that's what I always wanted to do is to sort of play like a, you know, an inspiring improviser. Something that you want to play with. Yeah.
So maybe I don't know. I mean maybe you like what you're hearing with Maxine in general with other people, but I wonder if there's a way to address that issue about listening.
Yeah.
You know, in a...
Right. Yeah.
John, you have an idea?
Well, I just wonder to what degree that might be different types of listening that aren't just having to do with sound, that it's not attentive to your body.
Yeah.
It's not attentive
you,
to,
right.
to the way you're moving
I've,
your arms
right.
or to eye contact
yeah.
or to...
Yeah.
That
all
it just
those
se-
other things
yeah,
we
it just
were
seems
listening
yeah.
for.
That
yeah.
seems like a huge part of what it is to improvise, even if your eyes are closed, but usually someone's keeping track, especially if someone's being empathetic to you in the performance, I assume they're part of that is, you know.
Does Maxine listen to music on her own?
No. I mean, no.
I mean, that might be a thing, you know, also, just that Maxine would listen to records of the person that they're going to play with and get sort of a sense already of kind of a vocabulary and an aesthetic of the partner.
Yeah, there you go.
So, yeah,
to map these
yeah.
things.
Yeah.
Right?
So, you
know,
is this what you do? You do
I don't know, but I mean, there
okay.
is sort of a certain level of, I think, improvisers knowing kind of to begin
what
with
the
person that they're going to play
yeah.
with. It's not necessarily that, oh, I listen to records of so-and-so, and now I just go and I do what they did on the record, because
right.
that's bullshit. But at the same okay. time, you kind of know
yeah.
you know the person on a different level than just like, I'm just going to do my thing, man.
Right.
You know, I'm me.
No, but
I'm
it's not
great.
Necessarily
I don't
about,
care about you.
Listening to a recording of someone and then getting to know them before the gig like that so much as just like taking it seriously that they sound a certain way. It's the only certain things are going to work better with this person than, no, not so much for you.
I think talking to Ken, you know,
yeah.
it's not so much about, I don't think you feel like it's that it needs to do what you want it to do, but it'd be nice if it, the word empathy is really the key word I think you use. It's like it could just decide, still, I'm gonna rip him up, you know?
Yeah.
But I know him. I'm not just ripping up a generic person that's making sound. I'm
right.
going for him.
Okay. So
you know?
that's where the real love is. Like, it's like a, you know, ripping Ken.
Or loving Ken or whatever.
Yeah.
But just like having
yeah.
having a point of view about Ken and not just having a generic, there's somebody who makes pitches and sounds.
Oh,
and
yeah.
you know, I'm going to do what I do based on like how I feel about it rather than how
yeah.
the ensemble.
I wonder if it were a little bit more nuance about like pacing,
yeah.
then it could begin to feel like that.
Yeah,
I felt like some of those things were like, oh, I wanted to hold back and then just be like really quiet and then build up the thing to that, or like do this, and do that, play it like that. You know, these kind of things.
Yeah,
these games, or sometimes just to like hold the thing for a longer time, but not do that as often, so that these pacing things. You like more like local surprises and things like that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you learn it from like, you know, listening to people you like, you know. Like even if we haven't specifically studied the music of the person that we're preparing to perform with, or we're thinking about performing with,
yeah.
it's like a catalog of musical gestures and types, and a lot of it has to, I think, for me, to do with pacing and structure.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
No, this has been a common complaint about Maxi and one of the things I tried to address with Bob. But yeah, I mean, I have this experience playing with Maxine all the time where I feel like I can't make it. It doesn't have a way of making a form. Although sometimes I feel like it magically does, and I don't really know why that is. Yeah, but no, it's definitely...
Part of that might be like having a feeling that maybe you could also turn on a dime.
You didn't feel like that.
And do something different,
right.
you know?
Yeah.
And then come back to the thing. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. These kinds of things that sometimes you need to do to make a form.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I felt like it was sticking pretty much to a lot of the same things. Right. And then you kind of.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's also a temporality, a certain amount of time you let it go where it begins to feel, you know. You begin to understand its constraints.
Right.
It's operating within, and it'll never completely surprise you with that, you know.
Right, it'll never completely come out of nowhere.
Yeah.
This stuff. Yeah. Any other thoughts. Yes, who's that?
Okay.
Hi.
Have you experimented with a kind of controlled feedback, basically having Maxine respond to whatever she's put out from a speaker that gets sent into the mic?
I mean, plenty. I mean, that's what, it might be the reason why it felt so intense, actually, is because when I workshopped this particular scenario, it was just Maxine solo, as you say, right? Because you're right, you know, it is basically just, it may have six arms, but it's basically just one, you know, tick. And so, I have had it play with itself, you know, play it, listen to itself, this feedback sitting that's been, how it develops, how I've sort of tested things out. Yeah, definitely.
I had one more.
Yeah, go ahead.
How do you know when to stop?
Oh, yeah, sure. Right, because when you played with it, it didn't have any capacity of this guy. So Bob has better time management skills. So what I had set Bob to do is sort of play for 18 minutes, and then after 18 minutes, look for an ending.
All right, but so that's right there, though, told it. It's not like an open-ended, it could have been a 3-minute or a 25-minute piece. It was going to be roughly 18 minutes.
Usually, it can often go longer than 18 minutes if I said it that way. It actually did go just a little bit longer, I think.
Yeah.
But
I mean, that's sort of like from Ken's
right, no, that's
about
weird.
Sort of structural things, is that sometimes the structure is just done at 3 minutes.
So, yeah,
right.
If I stopped at 3 minutes, it would have kept going for 18.
Unfortunately, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's true.
And if Ken really felt like it could have been 25 minutes, it's going to stop at 18 anyway.
Yeah.
It'd be interesting to see how you could program it so that it would have a sense of sort of, this is a good place, this is a good ending. Because, like, I think improvisers really value endings and knowing endings.
Yeah, they do.
And, like,
I mean,
better improvisers observe and are sensitive to endings, and often younger, like Maxine, improvisers are oblivious to endings.
Yeah. No, it's very frequent that Maxine is compared to younger improvisers. It's like, it reminds me of younger improvisers.
It's very young.
But I mean, that's just sort of that's also how you explain any sort of personality flaw, right? Is to say that, it reminds me of, you know, this kid I knew in high school. You can say that for anything where you think it's a negative flaw, but this is how people often describe things when they play with Maxine. One guy said that it's like playing with, when he was younger, he used to like to react to everything, and then when he got older, he learned to stop reacting to everything as sort of like an evolutionary. So people always.
If Ken and Maxine did another piece now, would it be very similar to what we heard, or would it be an entirely different, like would Maxine say, I'm going to skip the vocabulary from that piece and I'm going to work on a new angle?
It would probably be pretty similar, although I've been quite surprised in the past how different, like, one piece could be like it's there, you know, and then another piece, it's just, like, it didn't give a shit about one thing that I played. And, you know, it's like playing something.
Can we hear Bob or just Maxine tonight?
You know,
it's a lot to.
Well, you know, I guess, it's. I could, it's like intermission music you could listen to Bob. But if you guys still want to do a trio after, it's still, or would you rather hear Bob?
You want to hear Bob for 5 minutes?
You want to hear a 5-minute Bob? Okay, all right. Well, please tell jokes while I set up Bob.
I thought Bob and Maxine were working together.
Well, he was saying that sort of Berlin noise factor rather than spectrum pitch. So I thought that might be my thing to hear. Yeah, you guys playing your problem.
Oh, we're going to play.
Are you going to play with Bob?
No, I didn't know we were going to play with the robot at all.
Oh, no, you're just playing with
Rick. He's just going to listen to a little bit. Yeah, it's just going to be a big saxophone.
I thought you two were going to do another trio.
But right now, I thought what we were hearing was Bob performing Max about.
Yeah, but I think he was just sort of like a controller as opposed to a voice.
Right, okay.
By popular demand, here's Bob. Just one second.
You still have those bombs?
Yes.
Who's that? Uh-huh.
That's my attempts at using.
Good job, Bob.
Thank you.